Friends, this is 60th Friday group meeting. Speaker is Dr. Abhishek Manasinghvi, senior advocate, one of the topmost senior advocates of this country. He is also sitting member of parliament. The today's topic is institutional pillars of Indian democracy. Sir, now kindly initiate the debate. We are all highly grateful to you. Thank you very much.
Well, friends, let me start by congratulating all of you, especially the organizers. Shashti Purti is a very important occasion in the life of every Indian. It's a great cultural tradition. It's a special year. It's a special event. And this is, I'm told, I'm informed, the Shashti Purti of this sequence of lectures. I had heard of it, but it's very nice to know that you all take out the time, you make the effort, and you have the sutradhars who bind you together for this gathering. And he sent me a list of topics which was very wide and diverse. So I think it deserves congratulations that this close-knit group at the bar does take off Friday afternoons and evenings. And therefore, let me begin by giving you all a very, very strong, comprehensive happy birthday with many, many more events like this to come. Listening to this very generous introduction on the CV, I was reminded of my favorite anecdote, which I have repeated many times, but perhaps not to this gathering. And that's why I interrupted him. It relates to a bishop who was invited for an after-dinner address, as I have been invited for a post-lunch address. And like my generous hosts here, that bishop was introduced in very, very glowing terms, very generous terms, by the organizers of that lecture. So when it came to the bishop's turn to speak, as it is now my turn to speak, he said, I will begin by seeking two forgivenesses. And like the bishop, I also seek two forgivenesses. One for my hosts, for having clearly exceeded the bounds of truth. The second for myself, for having enjoyed it so much. So I wanted to make sure that I stop it somewhere in between before I start enjoying it too much. Friends, he was talking to me, Seshu, and said that perhaps there is a need for a wider topic, is what he said, a wider theme. So today is not at all a legalistic topic. Institutional pillars of Indian democracy is as wide as the universe. And therefore, I am going to perform the role of a fan dancer. The role is to try and touch upon the subject or the sub-subjects without really covering them. Because it's a very vast topic. But it's a topic which is of vital interest and importance because it deals with what you and I every day take for granted. And what you take for granted, you don't cherish. You don't value. You do not give it the requisite importance. And sometimes when we discuss the institutional pillars of Indian democracy, we sit back and we are able to think and reflect as to how fortunate we are in this country. And we have to thank our blessings, despite the rightful multiple criticisms which we have of this country, which we should continue to have because they are intended to be constructive. But ultimately, to preserve, protect, promote nation building, we need to be aware both of the foundations of these pillars and of their future trajectory, their future improvement, and the deficiencies which need to be addressed. So, before I come to the actual pillars of Indian democracy, let me start with what I think is a very simple but a very telling question. I usually start this with many foreign audiences, but also with Indian audiences, I find an equal mystery about the answers to this question. And the question which I formulated some years ago was, why is it that India alone, out of some 25-30 odd nascent democracies, which emerged from the yoke of imperialism, from Belgian imperialism, from French imperialism, from English imperialism, from Dutch imperialism, spread across Africa, Asia, South Asia, South America, some 25 odd countries between the 1930s and the 1960s, from Fiji to Africa to South America. Why is it that there is only one country, especially of the size and width and length of like India, which has remained a vibrant democracy? That's a remarkable telling question that I do not know of any other country which has emerged from the yoke of imperialism in the recent past in the 30s and 40s, and has remained, nevertheless, a vibrant democracy, and certainly no country of the size and the width and the depth of India. Well, I don't know, everybody will have their own answers. My first answer to my own question is, good luck, that's it. Because there's nothing like good luck. We've remained a democracy largely because of good luck. And there is no gainsaying that answer. That's of course also an easy answer because it avoids analysis. But the second answer, and each person's answer will vary, I'm sure you'll have different answers. My own answer would be that we were lucky to get the sequencing right. The sequencing which we got right was Gandhi followed by Nehru. And sometimes in jest and in jocular manner, I say had the sequencing being the opposite, there might have been a disaster. Why is that? Because Gandhi was the eternal agitational politician. There is nobody better in the 20th century to have got any country independence than Gandhi. Gandhi was a bundle of contradictions, but a person who alone with his special brand of agitational politics could have got freedom. For example, professing Ahimsa, which he turned into an atom bomb of Ahimsa. And he therefore got us independence. I can't think of anybody who could have, without bloodshed largely, got independence from Britain in the manner and in the way which he did. Nehru was in contrast the idealist, a somewhat in the air, ivory towerish idealist. He was, however, he had many failings, no doubt, but he had remarkable rare virtues and qualities. One of them was that he was in heart, mind, in thought, deed, action, an eternal democrat. He was suffused with the idea of democracy. He had his origins in the Fabian socialism, that liberal democracy ideals of the early 20s. He had been a student in England. I happen to have the privilege of studying at the same college as him, and I find in that college till today the only Asian, the only in fact foreigner, who in the heart of Trinity College Library has a beautiful picture, a photograph of Nehru. It is only Nehru who occupies that place in the heart of Trinity College. A very contemplative photograph, which is in fact not even found in India. But here was a person who believed in Voltaire's dictum. Voltaire had said that I disagree with you completely, but I will defend to death your right to disagree with me. That is the essence of democracy. Tolerance is a negative word, it's a more passive word. But this was clearly one of the great foundational virtues of Nehru. So this duo, first Gandhi and then Nehru, no other country, none of our eight South Asian neighbors had this combination. We don't know what would have happened in Pakistan had Jinnah lived. He died very soon after. But in each of the countries, and privately all the world leaders of Bangladesh and Sri Lanka and Pakistan and Nepal and Afghanistan will admit that if we just had had a combination, like at least post-independence, Nehru. Imagine Gandhi being there as the first Prime Minister of India. He was too idealistic. He could never run the country. And Nehru could never have got us independence. These are facts we have to admit. So I think this is a remarkable beginning of Indian democracy, and it requires the first 25 years for institutions to take root. Once institutions take root, then it becomes difficult to dislodge them. But institutions do not take root unless they're allowed to not only start having roots, but the roots are not wrenched free from the soil in the first 20-25 years. No other country had that protective umbrella which the Nehruvian ideals created. And I don't mean Nehru alone, I mean the entire system which he created in the first two decades of our independence. And we all understand and we know that parliamentary democracy, secularism, socialism, scientific temper, etc. were all foundational pillars of Nehru's thought process. And that magnanimity, which is the heart of democracy in the formative years, was there. Had he had an approach which was entirely narrow-minded, or vendetta approach, perhaps we might have had a different approach. So friends, without more ado, let's come back to what I consider the 7 or 8 pillars of Indian democracy. And let me start with the most maligned one, but nevertheless, which continues to be the most important, secularism. Secularism is obviously maligned. Everybody has abused it. I don't think anybody has not abused it. But what does it mean, actually? It is, I think, ultimately in India, a concept of self-preservation. We don't do any favor to anybody when we are secular in our approach. We actually need it for self-preservation and survival in this country. Why? Because India is planet Earth's most diverse spot. India is planet Earth's most diverse spot. You know, I laugh when my American friends tell me that we are a melting pot of cultures. Somebody says we are a salad bowl of... they are nothing compared to the diversities you have in India. And secularism is just another word to manage diversities. It's just a vehicle to manage diversities, which is vital for India's planet Earth's most diverse spot. Imagine, we are not only the world's largest democracy, we are also the world's second most populous nation, and probably will become the most populous in another 20 years. The 7th largest in area, the 3rd or the 4th in GDP on terms of purchasing power parity, 22 scheduled languages, which is very misleading because there are actually 700 mother tongues, 2000 dialects, 4 religions of the world, big ones born here, Hindu, Sikh, Jain, represented largest, not born here, but largest representation is in India. Second largest or third largest of Muslims and Buddhists. The maximum diversity of dress, food, smell, culture, music, dance, rituals. Now in such a system, can you imagine any other doctrine than secularism to hold you together? Secularism is therefore a binding force. And I believe the essence of India, the heart of the idea of India is, the more you let go, the more India stands together. The more that you pull, you know, in kite flying, even the children were taught on 15th August, sometimes you've got to let go to let the kite fly higher. If you pull it, it crashes. In India, I believe very strongly that the more you pull it together, it binds less. The more you let go, what used to call dheel in the old Hindi days, it binds together. That's the essence of secularism. There is a professor, Indian professor at Harvard years ago called Bhargav, Rajiv Bhargav, and he gave a nice analogy on secularism. He said, Abraham Lincoln, who as you know, by the way, was a completely illiterate man. He had never gone to formal education system. And it is rumored that he fought 24 elections from the municipality up to the Vice President of America. And he lost all 24 elections. And then he fought his 25th election and became President of USA. Abraham Lincoln, who had no formal education, gave this famous definition of secularism. He said, of the people, by the people, for the people. So Rajiv Bhargav writes, he says, by the people we understand. Obviously you elect by the people. For the people also we can understand. Democracy is for the people, secularism. So what is the meaning of the people? He says, of the people is supposed to signify a sense of co-ownership of democracy. So that every corner of every Indian should get a feeling that he has a small co-parsley Hindu undivided family kind of right in democracy. Like a undivided, unspecified co-parsley share. And that sense of belonging as a co-owner of democracy is what secularism is intended to convey. So that I think we must remember and keep as the fundamental pillar of Indian democracy, and it's my first pillar. And remember, you look around you, to all those 25-30 countries, in fact look across the entire developing world, you will hardly find this first fundamental pillar of Indian democracy. My second, and as I said, I'm going to be jumping, I'm doing a fan dancer's role, touching upon various things without really covering them. Perhaps we'll cover some more in the question answers. My second institutional pillar of Indian democracy is federalism. Federalism is another form of managing diversities, of creating shared identities. And again, I think you should see it as something which is like a safety valve. Many of us ladies here especially know the pressure cooker. There's a safety valve. It comes with a whistle. Well, safety valves are important because they allow the pressure to build up and also to come out. It controls the pressure. And federalism is really something like that. Somebody said nicely, he said, it channelizes the three dissents, the three Ds. It controls and regulates the three Ds. The Ds stand for dissent, dissatisfaction and discomfort. And it does it at the local and the state level. If all the bottled up energy of Indian angst and anger was to explode at the center, India would become ungovernable. So federalism is a different manner, like secularism is, of managing diversities, but diversities which would otherwise implode and explode at the top are frequently settled at the state level or the district level or the taluk level. And as they said, it quarantines conflicts. It prevents conflicts from exploding at the top. In fact, it's a very fascinating journey if you read parts of the Constituent Assembly debates. Our founding fathers' maximum pages in the Constituent Assembly debates, the Shivarao volumes or other volumes, was spent in federalism. They had the model of USA, which is pre-existing independent states ceding sovereignty to form a new country. Remember, most states in US, many states, not most, were independent countries. And they gave up their sovereignty to form the United States of America, which is why they had to create a Senate, which meant each state must be represented. He is a state of two people, you are a state of 2 million people, but each has equal powers because each was a country before. And some other states were purchased to make it 50 states. So the founders had the US model, which was what we might call true federalism. Because true federalism is that virtually each state is independent. You know, in the US you have each state having its own courts. You have a state Supreme Court, a state High Court and a state lower court. So on individual citizens, two sets of courts operate, a federal court and a state court. Then they had the model of UK, which was completely unitary. It was the other extreme. There is hardly any federalism in UK. It's a small country, it ruled the whole world, but there is hardly any federalism. And they debated and they debated and they debated what should we adopt. And they were interested in adopting a US model. The debates will indicate that. And then there was a countervailing theme, the fear, that today we are struck with fissy Paris tendencies. This country, India, is falling apart. Because remember, and to salute our founding fathers, we were in the middle of partition, the world's largest human migration. Thousands, lakhs dead and millions shifted. And huge religious tensions. And in that, they said, we also have to create a constitution which will not allow this country to break up. So they had these two conflicts. So they created, basically, ultimately, a unitary system. They leaned towards the side of UK, but with significant US elements. So an Australian constitutionalist many years later, in the 50s, gave the correct word for India. It is neither federal nor unitary. He called it quasi-federal. That is Kenneth Weir, who gave this phrase, which we now use in our judgments. It is actually quasi-federal. As with everything in India, we do some kind of a khichdi, but it's a positive khichdi. So it was, well, a quasi-federal. Now, therefore, the original intent of the framers was largely unitary, with some federal features. Remember, the leaning inside of unitary, the UK model, with some federal features. Not leaning inside of the true federalism, with some unitary features. And the interesting point I want to make now is that the very, very fascinating journey, which can be part of a separate lecture altogether, and many books, is how in 70 years of our democracy, we have actually travelled from that model in theory, and our constitution remains the same, which is basically quasi-federal, more unitary and less federal, but in practice has become significantly more federal. So people have rightly coined the phrase unintended or inadvertent federalism. India of 2017 is far more federal than the constitution permits us to be. India in practice, in reality of operation, is far more federal than our framers imagined. But the constitutional theory remains the same. And I will give you four or five reasons why the original unitary intent of our framers, which was to prevent division of India and fissy Paris tendencies, has been diluted in practice. There are about five reasons why unintended federalism or inadvertent federalism operated in India. One is linguistic federalism. I just told you we have 700 dialects, 22 scheduled languages in my home state, Rajasthani and Bhojpuri is also being added, etc., etc. So, in the 60s, especially the young lawyers of today have forgotten, and I was not that old in the 60s myself, used to have language riots. You had language riots because language is a major issue in India's federal structure. Ultimately, we got it right. We had killings, we had big problems, but we got it right with the three language formula. You will notice that from 1960s till today, and some of it is starting now, but you haven't had a language riot. You had some jhagda, some comments, some agitation, but you haven't had a language riot. Remember, language riots killed people. People in Telangana immolated themselves. There were a lot of, so, the three language formula is an example of linguistic federalism. What is it but linguistic federalism? Our framers never thought of linguistic federalism. The second example of unintended federalism is fiscal federalism. In the early years of our constitution, the amount which the center gave to the states hovered between 20-25%. At the peak, it reached 30%. I don't think any finance commission report or other, you know, we have a system by which if the center gets 10 rupees, he has to give 1 rupee, 2 rupee, 3 rupees to the states, etc. But it never crossed 30%. Today, for many years, 45% of funds by way of grants or by other devolutionary processes like the finance commission effectively reach the states. And it is going to be touching 50%, I think, in not more than 5 to 7 years. Now, if 45% of your funds go down to the states, that is fiscal federalism in a very, very big way. Makes lakhs of crores of rupees. The third is the greatest revolution of decentralization we've had, Panchayati Raj. Panchayati Raj, today as a member of parliament, when I go to, I have 400 social welfare projects running in Rajasthan. A member of parliament can give MPLED funds. I have given for 400 projects of only health and education. When I go and examine them or inaugurate them or see them, etc., you will not believe it, 50% or the other, I am sitting across the table from with a woman. The panch head or the panchayat samiti head is a mahila. We have now, 3 years ago figure I have, roughly 1.5 million office bearers which were women in the Panchayati Raj. Now they are going to be about 2 million I imagine, this is a 3-year-old figure. Which means that huge amounts of money of devolution, how to build wells and local bridges and roads and decisions are taken. I understand many of them are proxies. I understand many of them are controlled by fathers, brothers or husbands. But that is changing rapidly. That is decentralization. Panchayati Raj itself is decentralization. I don't know how many of you know. You know the 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution, which says that there is a central list, there is a state list, and then there is a concurrent list. That's for the central government. Is a similar, there is a list for the panchayats. There are some subjects which the state, but there are some subjects only a panchayat can decide. A local road can't be decided by the state government. Now that is huge devolution, and that was brought partly by on the basis of a committee report of 1985 called the L.M. Singhvi Committee Report, which led to the 72nd Constitutional Amendment of devolution of power, because federalism is devolution of power. The fourth one, again, a different kind of federalism, unintended, is this huge, humongous judicial review. Prior to 2000, I'll give you a very simple statistic. Prior to 2000, we've had 99 examples of president's rule. Now, 356 in our constitution is actually an erosion of federalism because it allows the dominance of the central government. It is, in effect, a takeover, a constitutional coup by the center over the state. So the center says, this becomes my state now. You have no democracy here, you have no chief minister, you have no council of ministers, you have no assembly. So 356 was used 99 times prior to 2000. Do you know how many times it's been used after 2000 to now? There's 17 years down 2000. My counting is 4 times probably. Two of them we appeared in recently, I appeared myself, Arunachal and Uttarakhand. One was Bihar and the other was Bombay, which was pre-2000. Why is that? So this is again federalism because of far lesser use of 356. And that is because of judicial review. after Bommai, followed by the Bihar judgment, what is the name? Rameshwar. And of course now you have Uttarakhand and Arunachal. You cannot easily, the judges earlier were hesitant to interfere in 356. Now judges not only injunct 356 or subsequently quash it, but they restore and reinstall. And Uttarakhand is the only example where before the dissolution we got an injunction and ultimately no dissolution took place. All other examples of 356 and judicial review are ex post facto. This is the first time it happened. Now therefore the result is central governments are scared of getting a rap on the knuckles from the Supreme Court. And therefore 356 down to vanishing point is a great victory for federalism. And last one is economic liberalization. From 85, actually the date for economic liberalization in our country is 85, not only 1991, but significantly faster from 1991. Economic liberalization means that today, to be very honest, the power of a central government cabinet minister, do you know, is half, if not one third, of a chief minister of a state. The central government powers are very limited. A chief minister, who is the same rank as a cabinet minister, has at least three times as much power as his cabinet counterpart. Do you know, just 10 years ago, 12 years ago, a chief minister had to take permission to go abroad to get investment for his state, what we call road shows now. You could not go to get road shows investments for the state of Andhra Pradesh. Today, the liberalization has meant that there is again federalism, autonomy, state power, state decision making, lack of controls by the center. So I've given you five reasons why unintended, inadvertent federalism has capaciously increased despite the original intent of a unitary state. And that is my second pillar, institutional pillar of Indian democracy. The third, friends, is socialism. Well, it's a very dirty word again, I know. And we've crossed the age of socialism. It's not a very fashionable word now. It's not nice to be socialist, but it will be liberal or to be a corporate capitalist. But remember, we are a poor country and we will remain a poor country in relative terms. There are many Indias within one. I might think that I am poor, but there are far poorer people than me. And those poorer people may think they are poor, but there are far poorer people than them in India. India is many Indias in one. And as long as India is poor, you ultimately had to have had the original 30 years based on the socialist model. And I'm the first to admit candidly that perhaps the Nehruvian model of socialism outlived its utility by 10 years. The main difference between India and China is China and India did exactly the same trajectory, but they stopped their socialism 10 years before we did. It's exactly a 10-year difference if you date the things. That fellow who came after Mao Zedong, Deng Xiaoping. Deng Xiaoping stopped it exactly 10 years before we did. We stopped it 10 years later, so we are about 8 years behind China in the rate of growth. But to suggest that the first 25 years or 20 years, if you had no socialism, you know, our IITs, our IIMs, our steel, our pharma, our textiles, all the pillars which today, you know, I have been one of those people who have been 6 times to Pakistan. The first time we went to Pakistan was an invitation. Soli Sarabji and I were invited to speak in 86 in Pakistan. 86 is not so far away. It is about 30 years after our independence, 35 years. Till now, and certainly in 86, I found that in Pakistan, from cars to toasters, from steel to any other, everything is imported. That is true of many of our South Asian neighbors because they did not have the foundational pillars. Now I know Steel Authority of India is a very inefficient way of producing steel. Bokaro steel plant is an inefficient way. But they became inefficient because they were continued beyond the 80s in the same fashion. But if you did not have planning, if you did not have Mahanalobis, if you did not have the planning commission, if you did not have the fundamental pillars which have created for us a foundational basis, then I think we would be in difficulty. So, socialism may have outlived its utility, but it was a necessity, according to me, in the first 20-25 years of our independence. And I call it, therefore, the third pillar, institutional pillar of Indian democracy, without which Indian democracy would not have flourished. Socialism's ultimate object is, and remember, we're not talking of communism, is to see not only that the size of the cake grows fast. It is to see how the cake is distributed. You cannot always grow the size of the cake unless you also see how I cut the pieces of the cake and distribute it. And both have to go together. So distributive equity was a very important part of our Indian socialism. And to just end on socialism, we have a new brand of socialism in the last 15 years, not the Nehruvian style. We have now a new brand which I think is equally necessary, though it may be maligned and criticized, which is social welfare. India created in 2004 or 2006, the world's largest social employment program. You know, you go abroad, you have this, what is it called, dole. Dole, in all countries you have dole. You don't work and you get $20 or $30 a week in America and UK and France, etc. Well, this is a different kind of dole given to our poorer laborers called MNREGA. It's the world's largest social welfare program. And we may criticize it, but you don't know what it has meant, a lifeline on the ground. And I entirely agree, it requires reform. We should make hard assets. We should make sure that the Aadhaar prevents leakages. But at the end, it remains a vital sustenance. You know, when the banks took a hit around the world globally in 2008, what saved India, the poor of this country, was MNREGA. You have the world's largest Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana. It's a very incomplete Yojana, but it covers, that one covers about 50 million people, MNREGA, and 90 days guaranteed employment for every adult in a year, covering now almost a little less than a billion. The Swasthya Bima Yojana used to cover, I don't know the figure now, more than 50 million people. The food security bill, guaranteeing supply of 35 kilograms of wheat and similar amounts of rice in the alternative per family per month, covers 800 million individuals. This is social welfare. It is not efficient, it is not the best, but as long as India remains not only a poor country, but a country with distributive equity, which is skewed or slanted, it is vital to look at what I call contemporary socialism. The old one was Nehruvian socialism, this is contemporary socialism. Friends, my fourth pillar of institutional pillar of Indian democracy is two words, parliamentary democracy. We tend to forget that we are talking of democracy, not alone. We're talking of a word which comes before democracy. We have a parliamentary democracy, so it has to be both parliamentary and democracy. Both the words go together. Parliamentary democracy is vital. We have chosen a system, we have to try and improve it. I always say that the strength of Indian democracy is that when Mr. Vajpayee goes out, he telephones Dr. Manmohan Singh and says, "Congratulations, you have won the elections. Please come to my residence." And when Dr. Manmohan Singh goes out, he telephones Modi and says, "Congratulations." When we sit in Central Hall, the old tradition in Central Hall in Parliament was that you would have Party X, Party Y, Party Z, Party A, Party B all sitting together having a cup of coffee. And everything under the sun would be discussed. And the rule, conventional rule, which is now violated, is that everything was off the record unless you specifically told the press chap, who was also sitting there, that it's on the record. He would never report it. Now I'm asking you a simple question. Can Nawaz Sharif and Ziaul Haq sit in the Central Hall of Pakistan? Do they ever? Can the two ladies, Khaleda and Hasina, sit together in the Central Hall of Bangladesh? This is something so simple, but it is the essence of Indian democracy. This is parliamentary democracy. Parliamentary democracy, therefore, friends, is based upon the concept of dialogue. Parliament is called the temple of democracy because it is the grand inquest of the nation. It is the grand inquiry. Your Commission of Inquiry, the Commission of Inquiry Act, this is the grandest of all commissions of inquiry. And it is, therefore, sometimes, you know, made fun of. The old joke used to be, Pilu Modi used to say, and now I can say that about the Supreme Court also, that the shape of the building represents the content of its deliberations, which is zero. As you know, the parliament is made into an oval zero. It's all round. You go one way, it's the Rajya Sabha, you go the other way, it's the Lok Sabha, it all comes into one zero, and now I believe the Supreme Court is looking like that also. But anyway, please don't hold me for contempt of court. This is in the lighter side. But,
off the record.
Well, Thank you. But therefore, parliamentary democracy is a cherished ideal which we again take for granted. And we must therefore keep the debate alive. What are my problems with parliamentary democracy? There are many, and I'm going to highlight three. One is growing narrow-mindedness. The freedom and the spirit of central hall is going. That is the theory I described to you. It was there in practice till recently. But there is now suspicion, there is hesitation, there is finger-pointing, there is restraint, there is a feeling of being spied upon. And I'm not talking politics, I'm not talking party, all across. And you know, historically I think Indian democracy was always strong because there was minimal vendetta politics. The first time the brand came was in Dravidian politics in Tamil Nadu. It then travelled from Tamil Nadu much, much later, briefly to Punjab. And then in a small way to Bengal. But even today, barring three or four states, we don't have that brand of politics. The moment we start getting a brand of Pratishodhwali Rajniti into Indian democracy, it weakens parliamentary democracy. And I think that spirit must be kept alive. And I think that is true of every MP, every MLA who must try and keep the spirit alive. But one of the main problems, the one problem in Indian parliament is that members of parliament have no power to initiate legislation. This is a major problem. You know, a legislation must be initiated only by the government of the day. And the government of the day is a subset of the legislature. So the legislature is the superset. A small group out of that becomes the cabinet, which is called the executive. And they alone will initiate. Only the cabinet will initiate. They will then bring it to the superset, the assembly. But a individual parliament, any member of parliament, ruling party or non-ruling party, cannot initiate legislation. There is one exception, which is only a theoretical exception, the Private Members' Bill. The Private Members' Bill has a nice tradition that it's only on Friday afternoons, but never becomes an act. It is for letting your gas out, speak. People come, people ask, look, Panjwani is a good friend of mine, please come, I'm going to be moving a Private Members' Bill, please come and sit in the house. So I will move a Private Members' Bill, Panjwani will speak in favour, everybody will give nice, but then at the end, on an assurance from the Speaker, it will be withdrawn. It never becomes, only twice in the history of India, or thrice, Private Members' Bill have been adopted by the government and become Acts of Parliament. So, this is a very limiting factor. It limits the vibrancy of democracy if an MP cannot initiate legislation. If I can initiate legislation and all of you here are supporting me, why the hell should I not be able to initiate legislation? The second weakness is the whip. Now, the whip, I can understand, should be used for no confidence motions. Because ultimately a political party must have its flock together. No political party functions in the abstract that everybody can go and vote as they like. And you have the 10th schedule, no problem. But for that the simple answer is designate any resolution as a no confidence motion, whip will apply. Which is already the law. You cannot move any motion and call it no. You have to designate it as a no confidence motion and then you move it. But the whip unfortunately applies in anything the government wants, they can issue a whip. Anything the party wants, not the government. The opposition parties also issue a whip. So which means, you have to be not only present, but largely you have to toe the line of that party. Where is the independence of thought, process, speech of the MP? An MP is a legislator. So it considerably weakens. So my suggestion for reform there is, simply amend, a one-line amendment is required. The whip will apply only for no confidence motions. Or you can designate five categories. For constitutional amendments, let us say, two-thirds. But why should a whip apply for everything? Because MPs have some wonderful innovative ideas. MPs have some wonderful original ideas. And they should be allowed to air it. And this so-called party discipline should not overpower originality, creativity and innovation, which is what Parliament should be all about. And lastly, of course, disruption, which you all know about. I think the very simple thing required there is that, and it's becoming better and better, I mean, the disruption is becoming lesser and lesser in the last few sessions at least. There should be an automatic suspension of allowances for all the hours lost collectively, like a mass penalty. And for individuals, there should be removal from house. It requires no amendment, all these rules are already there. But no speaker and no political party takes that action because we are all bound in an incestuous compact. So I think that will reduce it because obviously that is not very good for Parliament. My fifth pillar of Indian democracy is the Indian judiciary, naturally, has to be. I wrote an open letter to the incoming Chief Justice of India, which was published in the Times of India 2-3 weeks ago. I started my first paragraph by saying that you, Honorable Chief Justice of India, are the head of the world's most dynamic court by many decades, not now, with the maximum power that any Supreme Court can dream of having. You belong to a system which invented the most amazing doctrine, basic structure, which virtually ensures that India can never be a dictatorship, even in a semi-permanent sense. You invented PIL. Your boundaries of judicial review will make all the Americans and the South Americans and all the other countries which talk of judicial review blush. Everybody else copies you. And there is no limit. And let me tell you, the lawyers in this country are the best and the brightest. The judges also do more work in 1 week than countries do in 1 year. So you must understand that, and you are undoubtedly a pillar of Indian democracy because possibly, at least on a poll, the maximum faith and confidence, sometimes misplaced, is in the judiciary today. Not so much because the judiciary deserves it, but because there is executive abdication or legislative abdication. Well, if that be so, there are only two major problems with you, which you must address. One is the scourge of arrears, beating the backlog. And the second is corruption. I am talking about the system as a whole. Now, beating the backlog is something so simple, and it's been my special subject, I've lectured on it, so I don't want to take your time today, that it makes me laugh and weep at the same time as to why you can't beat the backlog. It's like the medical system discussing how to treat patients despite giving gleaming new hospitals, excellent heart machines and lung machines, but no doctors. How will you treat patients? We have roughly 25-33% vacancy, I'm giving you broad figures, in the lower judiciary and in the high courts at all times. For 70 years, there is never a time when less than 25% are vacant. Usually, in between 15 end and 17 early, almost 40% of our 1,100 judges, we have only 1,100 for a country like 1 billion high court judges, were vacant. Now, what's the point of having big seminars, big lectures, big discussions, big foreign trips, big study tours, if you can't plug a simple thing like that? So I've written that article, which I'll not repeat, about how you need to have a non-lawyer, non-judge managerial officer who starts cracking the whip, and you make a rule, irrespective of who it is, you will appoint a successor at least 6 weeks before an incumbent retires. Notify, not appoint, notify a successor 6 weeks before an incumbent. And this should happen at the district court levels, where roughly the vacancies are 25%, going up to 33% sometimes, and in the high courts. You will not be able to do it because you have your internal problems. But you cannot countenance a situation where you will arrogate and exclusively claim the power to appoint and then blame others. At the end of the day, you are the ultimate appointing authority. Then no excuse is permissible. You cannot say, I am the ultimate appointing authority under the one judgment, two judgment and the third judgment. You cannot have any power locus. The procedure is this, but when I send you the recommendation, you are delaying it. How can it happen? Your judgments are there, you've written it yourself. Well, if it happens, haul up a couple of law secretaries for contempt of court. End of the day, you even haul up the law minister. It'll stop happening. Because the rule is, a second assertion of a recommendation denudes the executive of any power. It's as simple as that. You cannot have a 2.5 crore arrears in this country, roughly. It goes down to 2 crore to 3 crore sometimes. Addressed by 33% vacancies. And it's the simplest thing. And I have always said that you must agree to disagree on some appointments and appoint the rest. This I have never understood in our country. You will send a list of 18. And because one name, Singhvi, you are against, all the 70 will not be appointed. I have never understood this. Tell me a good simple, we are giving big lectures of human rights here, we are talking of big principles in courts every day. Why can't those 17 be appointed if there is a problem with the 18th? It frequently happens because either somebody is interested in the 18th should not lose seniority, and therefore he will rather sabotage all 17 rather than allow that one 18 to become junior. These things have to stop. You know, none of these are doctrinal, intellectual matters. They are managerial matters. Somebody once said, war is too serious a matter to be left to generals as far as management of war is concerned. I believe law reform is too serious a matter to be left to lawyers and judges as far as management of law reform is concerned, because it requires ordinary managerial practices, and I think this country cannot afford this remarkably great system in which people have so much faith and incessant talk, but still the arrears hover at 2 crores minimum, I would say 2.5 crores. I mean, can you imagine that 100 vacancies in Allahabad stroke Lucknow were there till recently? 100. Can you imagine that there were 60 judges? And you are talking about arrears. How is it possible not to have arrears if 100 vacancies in one high court, the total strength of which is 160? It is still, I think, 70. The vacancy today as I speak is about 70, which is not a small vacancy. So, this is something we have to, you know, Rani Palkhiwala put it very well. He said, justice is known to be slow, but in India it represents the pace of a snail, and it would be considered unduly slow in a community of snails. If we were to enter the Olympics, if the Olympics had a event called litigation, India would win gold medals every Olympics. And if they had eternal litigation, they would win even more gold medals. So this is something I think we have talked long enough. We must stop immediately and find 5 or 6 simple systems which we apply. And they're all obvious. They are in my article. They are written by others. It requires ordinary common sense, no uncommon nonsense, and it will be happening. But we are not able to do it because each person wants to leave a stamp. Each person talks, but it doesn't get done. Well, that's my 4th pillar. And my 5th pillar is the press of institutional pillar of Indian democracy. Obviously, the press is a very vital pillar. And we had on last count more than 400 dailies published in this country, more than 500 channels. The peak viewership is supposed to be 800 million. Imagine the reach and the width. And we are not even counting social media. All this is excluding social media. What you tweet and what you Facebook and what you do, all this stuff. This is a fundamental pillar, and I think all of us respect the press for the remarkable achievements. But it is riven with vices. It's just full of vices. I wrote another article 2 weeks ago, which I think you should read, which I sent only to one newspaper because I knew no other newspaper would publish it. It was of conflict of interest within the press. So I sent it to Hindu. You should read it, I'm not going to elaborate. The press is the most incestuous club. It is your and my watchdog, as it should be. It is the watchdog of the judiciary, the legislature, the executive, the minister, the politician, the bureaucrat, the Aam Aadmi, everything. But there is no watchdog of the press by the press of the press itself. Today, and I'm going to only itemize them, you read my Hindu article. But one, paid news is not something, and this is important for you to know, is not something which happens in that hamlet behind Bareilly by a newspaper which is in Hindi, which comes locally. You always in your mind say, oh, paid news hai, wo toh wahan hota hai, kisi rural area mein hota hai. Paid news happens in the top newspapers today. You have to be blunt, you know, as Palkhiwala said, words must sometimes be an assault on the senses. Otherwise, it will not bring about change. The top newspapers have departments now, which have created a new word, advertorial. Have you ever heard of this word, advertorial? It is neither an advertisement nor an editorial. It is both. These are paid editorials. If you see many of these supplements which come in the top, I'm not talking of that poor fellow in the middle of Bareilly or the middle of Bihar district who runs a small newspaper, whom you are calling yellow journalism, they also do it. Lots of UP newspapers, Bihar newspapers do it, but the top people do it and they hide it. They have a department which come and say, you know, you are an industrialist who are making some food items, so we'll have a cookery at Taj and we'll publish it on the front page and the third page of that supplement which I come out with. And earlier it was just as a news, now they have a small line at the bottom right hand top which you can never read, let me assure you, which will say advertorial. This is paid news. Now this paid news goes much, much further. So the first reform is, you can't stop it. Have a system where at the end of each article, have two lines disclosing the conflict of interest. 50% will be cured. So you say, this article is written by Miss So-and-so on the Toyota car. This is actually done for the cars, it is not done for other articles. However, she was on a promotional tour to Japan, invited by Toyota to examine the new model. Then let the reader judge. This happens actually in cars, to be very honest. It doesn't happen in other articles. Second is that we are the most toothless, I'm sorry to use strong words, impotent body, which is of no use. And we all pat ourselves on the back because we are happy with that body as a policeman for the press. You know, what you do is, you have a body, you have an institution called the press, which is my institutional pillar of Indian democracy. You have it full of vices, and then you sleep well because you think we have a body also to regulate it, the Press Council of India. The Press Council of India, and I don't mean it by insult to any particular, head of that, as an institution is toothless. It is composed of all press wallahs who at the highest sit in a club and give a very grand sounding report, which has no value, no recommendatory value also, and is hardly ever adopted. You'll be astonished, Press Council has published reports of documented statistical paid news and said, look, he is guilty of paid news. And nothing has happened, the report is lying. Third is this TRP fraud, because now all this I was talking was print media. Do you know the biggest fraud in this country is what? TRP. Do you know what TRP is? Billions, not millions, billions of rupees is paid by me as an advertiser to this channel. Let us say he is X channel, NDTV or Times or whatever. He collects millions individually and all the channels put together collect billions in advertisement. The advertisement money which I give him is based on his TRP ratings, which are better than hers, and hers are better than his. It's like the ABC in the circulation for print media. The TRP is based on 8,500 meters, and now I'm told it is some 12,000 or 15,000 meters, which are known as giga meters, which kind of measure, placed anonymously across India to measure viewership. So they're supposed to go and put a small meter somewhere in his house, and then they come and check that in his house he watches the 8 to 9 so much, in 9 to 10, and they put it all over the country. And that 15,000 items of meters in a country of India's size decides the TRP rating, namely this channel is viewed more, he is viewed less, and he is viewed even lesser. This, I joked once, I said, the person who tries to measure viewership of 800 million to 1 billion by 15,000 meters should get the Nobel Prize for miniaturization. Because this is the most ridiculous way of doing it. And so long, and now the Hindu itself has published those articles. There are documented cases of him not only not doing it anonymously, but of bribing people to say that we watch this channel more and more because the meter is located there. And then that result is extrapolated, published, and all the ads are given on that basis. So what happens here is, the channel which is able to master the TRP, irrespective of content, irrespective of quality, irrespective of objectivity, gets more ads. And the more ads means the more success. The channel which is sober, more sense and less sensationalism, objective, will not play this game, will get less ads and get left out. This is TRP and it's a huge fraud. You do not have, therefore, an independent rating agency. The press doesn't want it. They will give you lectures and seminars. The press doesn't want it. Because it suits everybody. Is hamam mein sab logon ko maza aata hai is cheez ka. Then there is also, of course, the major problem of, I'll end on this part because it's a very long topic by itself, press, but, you know, sometimes it brings tears to your eyes. I'll tell you a live incident. Many years ago, almost 8 years ago, I had entered parliament in my second or third year of parliament, or something, third year, I think. On a Sunday evening, I had a throat problem. I was down with some tonsillitis kind of thing, feeling a little feverish. One channel, I won't name it, telephoned me to say that we have an expose coming up. Now, does it tell you that we will not show you, but please be ready. We'd like to interview you at 8 o'clock because we're going to do an expose. So I said, I would have commented. They said, we want your comments. I would have commented, but I'm not feeling very well. So I did not. At 8 o'clock, I saw that. And they had an 8-time Lok Sabha member of the Congress party who was a Minister of State for Home, who was a tribal from Maharashtra called Manik Rao Gavit. Short stature tribal, he could not speak English or Hindi. He would speak only Maharashtrian. He's an 8-time member of Parliament, Lok Sabha. And they showed him that he is conversing with a criminal in a jail and talking of money exchange and all that. He showed the sting and all that stuff they show you. Anyway, I saw it. I did not comment. I was not well. Next day, I went to Parliament. It was a Parliament session was on. And there was a huge halla, expose by Z and all. This is, I'm telling you, reverse, which you don't think of normally. This is what is, should be the strength of Indian democracy, although it's an exception. It doesn't happen normally. It's a rare exception. I went. So I went there. I saw Sushma Swaraj and I entered in my house, Rajya Sabha. And I went there. I saw Sharad Pawar. Everybody was coming. Very rare. So we sat down. And immediately somebody raised, this is Minister of State for Home. I found across from the Congress was in power then, from the opposition benches, from the Congress, everybody stood up and said, we know this man. It can't be Manik Rao Gavit. We have been on. And that poor chap was standing there. He can't actually converse in English or Hindi in an intelligible way. He said, I'm innocent. I was not there. Whose voice is this? But the whole parliament stood up and said, we've been on committees with him. This is not his voice. Every party stood up. And ultimately, that channel whose name I will not take had to apologize. Now, just consider the implications of this. You had a full program. And let me tell you, some very senior people commented on that program. Perhaps I would have also, had I not been unwell. This is the power of the press. And this is the margin of error of the press. But 99 out of 100 times, each one of us here is only too happy when one of you gets hit. We're very happy. We rub our hands with glee. And all of us love salacious, spicy stuff. And we suspend our powers of disbelief. You do not think what it does to the reputation of that person. And you don't bother to investigate the facts. It just happened. That man was a simple man and people stood by him. The seventh pillar is the Election Commission of India. And I'll not take more than, I think I've gone beyond. Oh my God, I'm sorry. I'll take 5 minutes more. The seventh pillar is the Election Commission of India. It has outstripped and outshone the best imagination of its creators. I don't think anybody thought of the Election Commission of India to be such a great success. No other, every other country has Election Commission of India. None has been so successful as India, as the Indian one. You know, we have 8.5 to 10 lakh polling booths, and now with the EVMs, which we have 15 lakh odd EVMs, we get the result actually by about 11 o'clock when it starts at 7:30. Do you know, till now, half of America does counting, half of USA, most of Europe. And I do believe there's a problem with EVM sometimes, but now that should be taken care of because it has been announced officially that every one of them will have a paper trail. What is known as the VVPAT, verifiable paper trail. But it is a remarkably successful institutional pillar of Indian democracy because, as Indira Nehru Gandhi versus Raj Narayan has held, democracy is a basic feature. Free and fair elections are a basic feature of democracy, and all of them form part of the basic structure of the Indian constitution. And you cannot have free and fair elections without the Election Commission. You know, the Election Commission could become a multi-millionaire. I don't know if you know this. They are the most sought-after body to conduct elections in all countries of the world. Every country wants to give them a $1 million contract. But unfortunately, they don't take it because they're not a commercial organization. They assist some countries in Africa and in South America. But every country says, we are having election. Please come and conduct elections in our country. Many South African countries and many election commissioners and chief election commissioners have told me that. And if they were in the business and if the Government of India endows them, it would be the biggest industry for the Election Commission to hold elections in India and abroad also, in other countries. The problem there is, of course, understaffed. It's a very, very small institution. And because of that, it relies on the staff in operation during elections, which is the state government staff or the central government staff. And that's where the problem arises. Part of it is, of course, controlled because they have the power of transfer, dismissal, disciplinary action. During the election period, every central government and state government staff becomes the staff of the Election Commission, and the disciplinary powers vest in the EC. But that's not good enough because there are some 10% bad apples who have concealed loyalties. And I think that part is where what I have called an election cadre has to be developed, which we don't have in this country yet, to make it even better. And secondly, there are too few people because the Election Commission has an adjudicatory role, a huge adjudicatory role. Many sections give it a judge's power. It has an advisory role, it has a policy role, it has a policeman's role. Now, three chaps sitting there with an army of state government and central government officers can't do these four roles effectively within a period of 2 months when elections are held. But still, a remarkable job because the logistics are 800 million voters, 60 days to 90 days spread over, law and order, results, 15 lakh EVMs, 10 lakh polling booths, or whatever, you know, the figures are staggering. The eighth spurious pillar of Indian democracy, which came up in a while, but which I've criticized, then I'm criticizing now. It is not actually a pillar of Indian democracy, but was for a while considered as a pillar, is public participation. And what public participation means is that I will hold an assembly and decide that 200 people in Mathura Road area want this law. That law must be passed. And if Parliament doesn't pass that law, I will hold a dharna, an obstruction, a strike, a agitation. This model we saw because of a great moral authority of a person earlier. But this is actually a bypassing of democracy. It bypasses all your elected models of democracy. At one time, it was considered the ideal because all our democratic models were considered venal and corrupt. But now, it has been realized, as Churchill said, that democracy is the worst form of governance, where it is the best of all available alternatives. Well, you cannot bypass the cabinet system of making laws. You cannot say that all of us in this room, 70 fairly intelligent individuals who do lawyering every day, we have passed a resolution that the law of Lokpal should be like this. And to hell with you, Parliament, to hell with you, the Cabinet, to hell with you, the MPs, to hell with you, the MLAs. If this law is not passed, I will burn buses and have agitation. And if you don't pass this law, you are dishonest and corrupt. You elected me and you jolly well change me next time. But till then you have patience. You can't short-circuit democracy by the electoral process. And I think public participation was the very, very high-sounding name given to actually an unconstitutional process because it short-circuits the Indian democracy. And the last two pillars, very quickly, lesser noticed, but their strength lies in their being lesser noticed. You know, anonymity is a very big strength. And two pillars of our democracy must have anonymity. And the more anonymity the last one has, the more strong India will be. The first is CAG. Now, of course, we have a new fashion that CAGs are also having the power to change governments. But that apart, CAG is still a very professional institution. And the CAG is not one man whom you see on the top. He's an army, it's a whole service. And they are the best and brightest accountants. And they are very, very good people. And you need to strengthen this. And my humble suggestion is that stop, and I'm not saying any party, all parties have done it, wrongly perhaps. Do not start giving post-retirement benefits to CAGs. Or indeed, to election commissioners. All parties are guilty. Strength of both Election Commission and CAG is ultimately diluted if the frequency of these post-retirement sinecures increases. There have been about three examples in the past. I hope they're not repeated too much. A CAG remains the accountancy policeman and he does a fairly good job and he's a constitutional authority. And the last is the most important. He should remain the Parda Nashin lady. The less you hear, the more strength the Parda Nashin lady has. If the Parda Nashin lady starts speaking up, then the entire glamour and glow goes, and that's the army. The strength of the Indian army is its anonymity. In England, nobody talks of the army. In India, largely, do we ever talk of the army? We don't talk of the army. It is like that behind the scene, omnipresent, omniscient, protective force, which is protecting us. The moment you start talking of the army, you will have constitutional and unconstitutional coups, which happened within 2 years, 5 years, 7 years, in each of our 8 SAARC labors. And remember, the army is that kind of a body where it is okay only so long as you don't taste blood once. Once the lion tastes blood, he becomes man-eater. There is no reversing that process. Only so long as the lion doesn't taste blood, is he not a man-eater. So prevent the lion from tasting blood even once. The army is not a recognized force in any major democracy of the world, be it USA, be it UK, and be it India. And that is the strength of Indian democracy. The word apolitical army is an oversimplification. Again, the same system must be applied, and this is also being violated, although in a minimalistic way. Do not give political posts to top army persons post-retirement. I'm not saying the army is so easily swayed, but over time, it will create a problem. And the army today is one of the proudest armies, and you've had examples right in our neighborhood, from Bangladesh to Ayub Khan, from Afghanistan to every other part of SAARC, across the world, in Africa, in South America. We are extremely fortunate, and India would not be India were it not for the professional army we have. So A, don't give posts, and B, do not drag them into politics. And that, I think, is the most important message for each institutional pillar of Indian democracy. There are many more contributory reasons for it, but these are pillars of Indian democracy. These are things which you and I take for granted. These are things which we must therefore value more than ever before, and these are things which we must look at with constructive criticism to improve, not to decimate, not to destroy, but to improve their working. Thank you very much, and I'm sorry I took more time.
One or two questions. Please, anybody.
Please, Panjwani sir. Dr. Singhvi, going to the initial part of your lecture,
yes,
quasi federalism, how is it different from, how is quasi federalism different from union of states? India is a union of states.
You are asking a very constitutional question, and I am glad you are asking it. Kenneth Weir coined this phrase, quasi-federalism. All it he meant was that basically you call yourself a federal country, Mr. India. You are actually a unitary country. However, you are not as unitary as India, as UK. You are a country more or less unitary like UK, but with some federal features. This is a phrase coined in 1956. So let's understand the meaning of the phrase. All that it meant was that basically you are fashionably calling yourself federal. You're not federal at all. You're actually a unitary country. Number two, your point about union of states. Of course, it is a union of states. And the phrase in the Indian context meant three states: British state, princely states, part A states, part the other sections, and the non-British India. British India, princely states, and the part ABCD, these small territories, etc. It did not mean a union of states as it meant in USA, where many states were countries. Texas was a country. Many other states were a country. Or they didn't belong to the. Alaska was part of Russia. Some $1 million was paid by America in the 19th century to buy Alaska. Today, Russia is kicking itself for selling Alaska. So, that's the difference.
Sir,
you just wound off by saying that the army's professionalism in the long run would get affected if they get post-retiral appointments.
Or are dragged into politics. Yeah.
Politics.
Both ways, yeah.
Sir, my question is, what would you say for the post-retirement appointments from the judiciary?
No, you're right. The analogy has some relevance. But it's, first of all, you can't extrapolate immediately.
No, I'm asking for an opinion because I have not yet found my own opinion.
No, let me answer. I'll give you as honest an answer as I can. This is a very warm, close gathering, and I'm not going to mince my words. Point number one: the army, in any case, has to be more insulated by anonymity than every other institution, including the judiciary. The judiciary functions in the public. The army does not and should not function in the public. So that's the first point. The judiciary has a public interface. It has to deal with litigants. The army does not and should not have a public interface. Got it? Their job is very different. Their job is to defend our borders. So that's the first distinction. Your analogy, therefore, is not strictly correct. However, your analogy does have relevance. In that, all institutions, and now I'm moving away from the army, and judiciaries included, are methods of allurement post-retirement, whether by sinecures or not. The difference with the judiciary specifically is that the tradition of the judiciary from day one has been of post-retirement activity, unlike other institutions. The CAG, the EC and the army are under the government. Therefore, the chances of influencing, distorting, controlling or slanting them is more. The judiciary is not an institution under the government. So that's reason number two. The third reason is, of course, that I do believe that in calibrated way, judiciary should be insulated and relatively regulated, but not an absolute Chinese wall. Now, I mean, we can debate that separately, whether you can be a governor, I don't think you can be or should be. Whether you can do arbitration, yes, I think you should do arbitrations. Whether you can hold a political post, well, should there be a cooling off period or not? Whether you can be anybody picked by a commission of inquiry, or you should have a system that you must go through a system before, because you know, as you know, most people are appointed commission of inquiry after checking up which way they are going to hold. So, these are matters of detail. You must, I agree, create safeguards for how you employ our judiciary post-retirement. But certainly, I think like an elephant, we can't define it, but we know when sinecures are used to get work done. There is a different standard of the Supreme Court, the different standard of the High Court, the different standard of the District Court. At all levels, we have to be careful that nothing which interferes, because we all know what I have called the sunset clause. The sunset clause starts operating from about 6 months before retirement, sometimes from before a year. And that sunset clause is very dangerous, because nobody wants the sun to set. And therefore, you must create safeguards for that sunset clause. Now, whether the safeguard is a uniform cooling off period or whether it is different for different levels of judiciary is a matter of debate. My own personal view is that we have an unfairness in our system. We retire our judges too soon. I mean, forget your 65s, but to retire a healthy man at 62 or a woman at 62 is pretty ridiculous. 75 is the universal age. And to retire our district judges at even 60 is even more ridiculous. So, given that, I don't think you can bar them, but for certain posts, create a longer cooling off period. So, if you have a 2-year, make it a 5-year. I don't think after that, this blame will remain. So, these are things, but that's the distinction between the army and the judiciary.
Yes,
so
you want
to
ask?
Yes, please. See, in a democracy, will of the people is sovereign. And will of the people is reflected by casting vote and making the representatives to represent in the state assembly as well as in the center, that is parliament. If those votes are purchased, whether the true democracy is itself demolished, according to me, how to prevent it, sir? Your comments, please.
Well, that you are talking of is an obviously, I mean, you have answered your own question. There is no question that democracy can have votes purchased.
Yes.
And but that's a more policing problem. That's a policing problem. And ultimately, it's not a policing problem also. It's, according to me, this is a simple problem. As education levels rise and as prosperity levels rise, this automatically becomes less. It's as simple as that.
Yes.
I agree with you entirely. It's a huge distortion of our democracy. But let me tell you one thing. You must also appreciate what we've achieved. You were living then. You're not so young, nor am I. Till 12 years to 15 years ago, you had this famous phrase, those of you who do Representation of People's Act matters, booth capturing. अभी 15 साल 10 साल भी नहीं हुआ मेरे को लगता आजकल कभी आप सुनते हैं बूथ कैप्चरिंग यू हियर द वर्ड यू हैड दिस फ्रेज ऑफ गोइंग एंड यू नो लिटरली बाइंग वोट्स ऑन मास यू हैव इट टू और थ्री स्टेट्स आई विल नॉट नेम देम इवन टुडे बट बाय एंड लार्ज इट इज आई वुड से मे बी 20% ऑफ व्हाट इट वाज 10 इयर्स अगो व्हिच इज अ ह्यूज इंप्रूवमेंट 80% इंप्रूवमेंट दैट हैज हैपेंड बिकॉज नॉट ओनली ऑफ ईवीएम्स not only because of more law and order but because of education middle class rising in india with the power and that's the ultimate answer you can't police it ultimately you have to go and catch them I mean there's nothing else you can do
sir one
continuation to her question queries she has asked about that post retail beneficiary agreement while retail so one question is that there is supreme court justice retiring He's sitting in the tribunal or somewhere else. His appeal is coming to the High Court or Supreme Court as well. Don't you think so as a parliamentarian, is a disrespect to the system as well, as a whole, judicial system?
No, because I don't think that. My objection is a little different. I don't think I'll agree with this because we have to, I have always believed that our system has to be less pompous. Our judiciary and all our other systems are also far too pompous. I have attended courses in America where I was sitting, this is about 25 years ago, 20 years ago, and somebody said, you know who's sitting there in the first row? So I said, no, I don't. So they were sitting in, some of them were in half pants and with colorful Hawaiian shirts. So he said, that chap is a Supreme Court judge of US, that is a court of appeal, that's a federal district judge. They were taking notes from somebody lecturing on patent law, and 25 years ago patent law was a big thing. So we are too pompous, our judges are even more pompous than normal human beings. You must demystify them. All of them should learn that they are not the repositories of everything, all knowledge. Nobody can be, neither you are nor I am. Now, having said that, I don't think they have to be that pompous that I have been a Supreme Court judge. And now they have chosen to be a tribunal judge. I don't appoint you against your will. Once I appoint you with your consent, you jolly well, a district judge can invalidate your opinion. You know, as former Chief Justice of India's opinion, can be ignored by a district judge. That's the law. So that's the point I think which is of more importance is that you cannot have a system where everything is decided by three or five people. What you are forgetting in your question, Yosh, is that today, even after retirement, very, very plump posts, and these posts are even more plump than as a judge. The tribunals are more powerful today in many ways. They are entirely appointed by the three people or five people. There are very few where even the executive has a role. So you breed yourself and multiply yourself, and inevitably your relationship, your favorites, your non-favorites plays a role in that. So this starts moving within a very, very close circle. Why is it that this country has not had non-judicial I question this whole concept. You can have, not for all, for certain posts. Why can't you have top people? Of course, it needs a very top quality of selection. Top people for certain posts which are non-judicial. One, of course, because we have faith in judges. That's a very complimentary thing, because not because we have so much faith positively, but because we have much less faith in others. But this fixation with having everything selected by those three chaps here or five chaps here, which is true of all our top tribunals, it's itself a real problem. You have to broad-base it.
Ja, last question.
Sir, the democracy is meant that the people's ruling. People runs the country by electing their representative. If you lost the elections and hold the executive post, how do you justify it? Whether my wish is a democracy or not?
Constitution permits it.
It's only on a morality, the propriety, since we are talking.
Yeah, but that's why the constitution put a specific clause.
Yes. Yes.
That you can, for example, and that was challenged, there's a judgment on that, that you can become a minister of the most important kind, even though you lost the elections or you are not a member of parliament. But in 6 months, you must come into parliament by whatever route. That's our constitution. Unless you change the constitution, no ethics comes into it, no morality comes into it.
Then how is
I understand. I understand your point.
Yes.
But I think So long as the same rule is applied to everyone, it has to apply to everyone. What can you do?
No, on a moral aspect, since the
moral aspect, you see, becomes a dangerous way to judge people, because then your morality is different from mine, mine is different from his is different from hers. So then it becomes ad hoc. So you have to have a certainty rule. You certainly could have rules, as many countries have, that you cannot be, you can be some kind, but you cannot be other kinds, unless you are from Lok Sabha. You even have that kind of a rule. You can be some kinds or not other kinds, or you cannot at all be a minister at all without being elected. So all that is there, but we took a choice. There is some, I mean, if you discuss it in a larger debate, there is some sense in it.
Since here you have been rejected, there you have options that you can acquire within 6 months.
Answer is only, you know, that's the challenge in that judgment which Justice Chief Justice Anand gave, that how can you have a person who's a minister without being a House member? So they've given a judgment on that also. Some Chief Justice Anand, I forget the name.
So we'll take your autograph here, sir, then your message back side.
Okay. Thank you.
Your signature. Last we'll take your message.
All good words for us.
Last we'll take your message. Very good attendance, sir, honestly. It's
very kind of all of you to
excellent
spend
attendance.
Part of your Fridays here.
Friends, I initially had to not mention two things. Mr. Singhvi contributed to this library nearly 25 lakhs, if I remember, 4-5 years back.
No, 8 years ago.
And the great father, that is Dr. L.M. Singhvi, produced great son.
It's kind of very kind of thank you.
Those who are in WhatsApp, they can put their valuable comments about today's speech of Dr. Singhvi and overall Friday group 60. Friday, whatever we...
Thank you for the relaxation.
Yeah, two days you can. two days. Because we should not disturb elderly people. That's the only aim, not other. Other, we should not enter to others' privacy midnight. That's the only 2 days you have free to do, write it up. Particularly those who are in WhatsApp. You are saying,
sir, with respect to the links written by Dr. Singhvi, article links, that also can be paid for.
I will send that.
Yes, sir. Sir, will send it.
Sir, he is asking
how many words? Is there any limit? No limit, sir. Depend upon your age and patience. Jatta ho nahi bolenge us rahenge hum. Any reasonable man, we will expect all reasonableness within the constitution and from the citizens also.
He say only thank you. Yeah, I'll write only 5 lines.
Please, please. No, great.
100 words.
Free to do that. Yeah, please, sir is writing message.
I read it because my handwriting will not be easily readable otherwise. Hearty and warm congratulations on your 60th birthday. It is truly gratifying that this band of close-knit lawyers with unfailing regularity give up part of their Friday afternoons in their thirst for knowledge and interactive dialogue. Full stop. The founders of this group deserve special gratitude for keeping this going as a true labor of love. Keep it up.